As we always do, we are just going to leap into this. That's the way to do it. Just leap into it and get it going. And we are not going to speak in parables here, even though we do have our little cove here. It's not a cove of parables. We're speaking very directly now and unequivocally and leaping into the effort. It's a wonderful Sunday morning here in the Bay Area of California. Foggy, still, quiet. But you know, not too cold. All is good, and so we're charging ahead right now because I'm fired up, as usual, to realizing the opportunity, realizing I see the, I can see the opportunity here. So let us feel that there is a great opportunity here, and let us settle down. So that our mind is in the mood of repentance here. Headed towards non-dual, meaning no winning, no losing. No winning, no losing, no winning, no losing. Natural state, which is bliss, which cannot be explained by duality of winning and losing, because there's no winning and there's no losing. And neither is there a combination of the two. And neither is, it's not nothing. You could say, and nor is it everything. You can't say what it is from the standpoint of dualism. So we are aiming for that goal, fired up to get that goal. So this morning I have been focusing on this, and we're close. We just have to be a little patient. Be a little patient in your life. And practice sitting quietly. Okay, this is the most successful strategy. Now, we have much greater clarity than before because we've been able to identify the logic of arrogance, the logic of arrogant deviation, and how it is inherently based on the idea of winning and losing. And that we've seen that because we really can't win, it's not possible to change reality. So it's not possible. It's not really possible to win without without something losing. So we really the winning is based on losing, based on the logic of arrogance. That winning is based on losing. That something has to lose. Something has to suffer defeat. What is that? God. God, in the logic of arrogance, we're trying to defeat God. So God has to somehow be defeated in order for us to win, because we feel that unless God is defeated, how can arrogance win and then claim that it can be the new prime creator unless God is defeated? So really it's based on defeat. The idea of winning is based on defeat. So if you have those who are very much following the logic of arrogance in getting advice as how to win, from either the fake God or the fake goddess, whichever one, however you want to describe it, which is our own advice, really, is really the logic of arrogance advising us, which we're the ones generating that logic. It's in some sort of an inexorable logic that has to function within this duality of winning and losing. If we follow that, if those who are following that, they have to have losers in order to believe they're winners. So if you have those who believe that they have to win and they're winning big, you have to look for severe losing. Okay, that's what they're really pursuing. And that's why we're politics and the social situation of the times and all times, really, there's always these severe losers taking place. And this is certainly the case right now. An entire civilization has to lose. An entire history has to lose. An entire this. And there has to be massive, massive loss in order to prop up the belief in some great, great victory. And this is part of the reason why there's this taboo against avoiding loss. Because those who want to win realize that they say, well, if someone has avoided losing, how can I be the ultimate winner? You know, this kind of thing. And so the idea of becoming the ultimate winner actually is based on the idea of having some ultimate loser, ultimate loss, oftentimes meaning that everybody, there are no winners. That nobody escapes the losing. Those who are, that they want to see losing, nobody can escape it. So, for instance, if we were to leave this planet and go somewhere else, they would find this to be intolerable because they say, well, maybe they're in a situation where they're not losing, and that is absolutely intolerable to us. How can we win when somebody is, you know, that we have targeted to be the losers are not losing? So are you starting to catch my drift here? Because this is really what's taking place in the world. And I'm getting wise to it now. I'm waking up to it. So I was, yesterday, it just hit me in a flash as I was just walking in the house. I suddenly remembered something that was very important. I had been reading history, and I was trying to untangle all the uncertainties about the chronology of Jesus, and which I didn't do, and nobody has done exactly. I tell you, you know, this is so that there are two probable timelines, and we can't really have a hard time pinning it down. And anyway, I was just going through all the machinations of the time. And saying, wow, you know, what struggle the men and women of went through, and what intrigues that they threw at one another and threw at the situation, and what desperate attempts to win did they do. And I could see it's all this desperate attempt to win on the part of women and men throughout history. And I also remembered, it's very interesting, when the suffrage movement and the feminist movement got going about women's vote, most women opposed it, or severely opposed to it. And that's why. And they said, what in the heck are you doing? We don't need the vote. We already are controlling things. We already have things the way we want it to be. You know, why put this extra strain on us? It's ridiculous. It was ridiculous because women said, we already have the vote. We already have all the power that we need. You know, we have things the way we want, and this is quite interesting. The modern age that we have now is what we would call the age of feminism, radical feminism, and it's likely to result in a woman president in the United States, who is a radical feminist, who follows this ideology. Now, the whole basis of this, that most people have forgotten because it seems to be swept under the rug, what I realized is I'm looking at history, I'm saying, wow, and feeling compassion on the entirety of history and the desperate struggle that resulted in people just losing their heads right and left. I was looking at John the Baptist, trying to determine his chronology of that, which is either AD 27 or AD 29 when he began his ministry, if Luke is to be believed. And he was imprisoned by Herod Antipas was imprisoned, And he was eventually beheaded by Herod Antipas. And the narrative of that is that he was criticizing the marriage that that Herod Antipas and Herodias, who was the wife of Herod II, which was his brother, actually, I believe. When they were in Rome, they fell in love in Rome, and they decided to get married. So they each, you know, got they divorced their spouse. They left their spouses for each other. So they were both involved in this, very much so. Ultimately resulted in a terrible war and the defeat of Herod Antipas, because his wife that he divorced went back to her family, and that family was so angry about it, what happened, that there ended up being a war over this. Anyway, as the story is told, the daughter of Herodias, which was Salome, danced in the court of Herod Antipas. And Herod was so thrilled, he offered her half his kingdom. He must have been very drunk. Or anything she wanted. He said, have anything you want. You can have half my kingdom if you want. And so Salome wasn't sure. She said, like, wow, what should I ask for? So she went to her mother, okay, and said, what should I ask for? This is how the story goes. And the mother said, ask him for the head of John the Baptist on a platter. And that's what she asked for. And then Herod Antipas he swore an oath that he would give her whatever she wants. He had to go through with this, even though they said he didn't want to. It was a very, very dangerous thing to do, because John the Baptist was extremely popular throughout the entire region. And this could lead to a rebellion, an insurrection. Why was John the Baptist in jail? Because he criticized the marriage and the divorces of these two rulers, and especially Herod Antipas getting married to Herodias. He said this is totally contrary to law, that the and that Herodias's husband, Herod II, had not died, so she just left him. And so this marriage was illegitimate. So this is John the Baptist saying this marriage is illegitimate, and is morally unrighteous, and it's bringing unrighteousness to the land. He's saying it's going to result in troubles for this land. So he was warning, saying this is bad, and this is why Herodias and Herod Antipas were so upset with him, so upset with him. Eventually, they were both banished by the emperor. They were not banished. Sorry, they actually did rule for quite some time, and then Herod Antipas was defeated in a tremendous battle, terrible defeat. But what we're getting at here is, as I'm looking at this, and all of the repercussions, there was so much marriage and intermarriage, and then changing wives and changing spouse husbands, and alliances, and hurt feelings, and intrigues. And you look at history and you feel the intrigue. You can feel it. You can see it. You realize, and I realized the intrigue so much of history. And it's mutual in intrigue. Both men and women were absolutely involved to the hilt, all throughout history, in the intrigues of history, the play of history. Why? They're both trying to win. Arrogance is always trying to win, and the winners must have losers. And you saw that the result in Rome of Tiberius and the play of that, how so many people lost their heads. Back and forth, shifting alliances, marrying here, marrying there, this wife intriguing this way, this wife intriguing this way, desperately struggling to get power. And you realize that the tapestry of history is the women and the men both valiantly struggling to be winners, and seeing the massive amount of losers throughout history. And you feel it. I could just feel it and know it. There's no question about it. And having compassion on all of it and say, wow, we have to get free of this winning and losing, this arrogance of winning and losing. This is delusion. This is a dualistic delusion. And I also read in Journey Beyond Words last night that Jesus says emphatically that we are spirit, we are one, we are neither male nor female, but spirit, one spirit. Very important, that's what we are. What we are has nothing to do with being either male or female. So we don't need a winner and a loser in this game of male and female at all. We can set it down recognizing it was one game of arrogance that we were playing. But what arrogance has done, the logic of arrogance, when you're not repentant, the logic of you're being pushed, compelled by the logic of arrogance, it's compulsive, and you keep trying to win. And winners need losers. They need losers because winning is basically predicated on losing, the losers. This shows, oh, there's a winner because there's losers. So there has to be losers in this arrogance. It's predicated on finding a winner. So instead of setting down both and saying, wow, this is just one play of arrogance we've been engaged with here, and we are not bodies, we're not genders, we're spirit. Instead of doing that, they're trying to pick a winner among the genders. They say the way to win is to say that what radical feminism has said is the way to win is that women are the winners and men are the losers now. So this is the logic of arrogance at work. So what the radical feminist did, and I was very much part of this whole situation, was they decided on a conclusion that they had. And they said, women are going to be the winners, okay, and men are going to be the losers. But how could they justify that women are this inherent winners? They said, women are inherent winners. They said, we don't have to win, we're inherently that way. And yet, you look at all of history, and there's absolutely not a speck of proof for that whatsoever. So what they did was they started out as their premise, is they said that, okay, history has been written by men. All of history has been written by men. And what they said was that men intentionally falsified all of history, and they intentionally wrote all the narratives about women that have ever been written about history were intentionally fabricated and lied about by men, by the historians, and that women really have been blameless throughout all of history. This is called the big lie of radical feminism. It's based on this huge lie, okay, which the logic of arrogance brought to their attention, said, hey, just believe this and you will be winners. So in order to say that they're inherent winners, that they don't need to prove that they're winners at all, that they're just inherent winners and men are inherent losers, they had to claim that the entirety of history, historical narrative, from millions and millions and millions of sources, all of that was a vast conspiracy to make women look like they were the losers, and it was all falsified. Every last bit of it was lies and falsifications, intentionally portraying women as schemers, as intriguers, as manipulators, And yet all the narratives, and yet the thing is, of course, that these narratives also, by historians, also included all the scheming and wickedness of men too. Both, you see. So you'd think if they were trying to, men were trying to make them portray themselves as inherently winners and women as the losers, that they would have portrayed themselves as these blameless people, when in fact that is not the case at all. All the wickedness of men, history brings it to light too. It brings to light the wickedness of both. the desperate intrigues of both. But radical feminism completely overlooked this and just said, history is a lie, plain and simple. And that's their foundation, that all of history is a lie, and therefore we don't need to even look at it at all. We feel that we are inherently winners. We don't have to do anything. So they feel that they just need, that they're justified in being handed any position at all, even though they're not even qualified for it in the slightest bit, or that their lives are full of intrigues, which, for instance, Hillary Clinton, for example, her life is absolute tapestry of intrigue and lies and deceptions and desperate attempts to win at all costs. And yet, from the standpoint of radical feminism, she's absolutely blameless. All these accusations of manipulation and cleverness are all lies that men have conjured up to make her seem less than perfect. You know, this is the ideology. It's fascinating to look at this play of history here. And this is what we're going into. We're going into this age where women are completely blameless, have never done any, they can, no matter what they do, and never, any complaint about it by men is a lie. Plain and simple, because they've already said that all of history is a lie. And so, and men have completely falsified history, and they say that men are intrinsically evil, they're intrinsic liars, and that any criticism of women is an intrinsic, inherent lie. This is what they've said. So therefore, what they're really saying is you cannot criticize arrogance. That's what they're saying, that arrogance is an inherent winner. And any criticism of it is an inherent lie. And in order for this to be true, there has to be a loser. So the logic has to split the genders now and say women are winners, men are losers. Whereas repentant mind doesn't have to do that. It can say, you know what? We're both caught up in this dualism of arrogance. And we both need to repent. And we're neither male nor female, we're spirit. So this is how repentance looks at it. So repentance doesn't have to be Pollyannish about it. It can easily see the scheming of both men and women. It doesn't have to pick a winner or a loser. And this is something that arrogance doesn't understand at all. So we're in this extremely ideological time where there's this desperate attempt to come up with a winner. And therefore you have to come up with a loser too. And men have been tabbed as the losers, inherent losers, which is why you have all these women becoming CEOs of these companies, having these, it's just amazing what's happening. And some of them are okay, some of them are disasters. But of course, the disasters, they blame it all on the men. You know, the men didn't support them. The ideology says that women are inherent winners. They can't lose. So they can do no wrong. Can do absolutely no wrong. This is the fundamental ideology that the world is in the grip of right now, that women can do no wrong, and it's all the men's fault. And of course, men are feeling this very strongly, but they just don't understand what's going on, and they think that somehow it's all going to work out good for them. No, it's not. It's not. So, this is what's happening, and I just let this sink in, and just, wow. We don't realize that, unless you were there at the roots of the situation, and you realize that this is what was happening, is the women got into, they've gotten, taken control of universities now, and they are completely rewriting history. They're being totally, extremely revisionist. And it's the stuff they're writing is just, I'm just astonished by it. It's just completely arrogant. They basically are just saying, okay, this is how I want to see history, therefore this is the way it is. Extremely sloppy science. Extraordinarily sloppy science. As someone who values getting it right, you know, it's just appalling how they leap to conclusions and basically say, look, anyone who opposes this, you know, you're just refusing to accept that I'm infallible. You know, It's just this logic of infallibility. And they can claim, you know, anything, any kind of revisionism they want. And same with, like, scientific studies. There's a conclusions that they want, and so they just reach that conclusion, and everything else doesn't matter. You know, any objection to it is just the losers trying to smear the inherent winners, that kind of thing. This is the logic that our academia is running on. The new science tends to be running on this. Politics, social, everything is running on this logic of the infallibility of women, and they can do no wrong. So they can reach any conclusion they want. As long as they want it, they're the ones who want it to be that way, then it is. So they're the ones who want to rewrite history and completely revise it into something that never was, actually. They're the ones who want to lie about history totally, actually. They're the lying revisionists, and they projected that. Arrogance had a desire for this winner, so it had to believe that there's an inherent winning like this, and so it had to then rewrite all of history and lie about all of it and say, no, that if you say that we are inherent winners, then we could never have done any wrong. We've always been absolutely right, and it was the men that were just getting in the way causing all the troubles throughout history, instead of realizing both men and women. It's a dance of arrogance. Arrogance has split itself into righteous and unrighteous, so dualistic struggle, okay? And trying to produce a winner and loser out of this, so there's this constant struggle throughout history. And the fact is that women right now are exactly the same they've always been. Full of struggle to win, whether it be scheming this way or lying this way, manipulating this way, very cleverly doing this dance. And men are the same way that they've always been. There hasn't been any change at all, actually. And yet we're told that we've had this revelation. It was like a revelation in the 70s, and radical feminism had this, like, you know, cosmic divine revelation. Like, oh my gosh, now I see how to win. We've always been winners. And anything that's in history that says otherwise is a complete fabrication and a lie by the losers, the liars, who intentionally were so bitter that they're not winners, that they had to slander us and smear us all this time. And we're not going to stand for this anymore. We're not going to allow any more slander of our inherent perfection as a woman, as a body, as a person, as a winner. See? And this is the ideology that is coming upon us right now. This election in the United States is all about that. And this is why we have a feeling of doom. Most men have a feeling of doom here. Because these ideologues are under the spell of the logic of arrogance. And the logic of arrogance, as history has shown, is ruthless in demanding losers, that losers suffer the punishment they deserve so that they can feel that winners get the prize that they deserve. Okay? So Herodias demanded the head of John the Baptist, who was criticizing the marriage, because she held that this marriage was going to help her be a winner. Okay, and the criticism of John the Baptist was intolerable, because it threatened breaking up their marriage, which she would then be disgraced by this machination, this Machiavellian machination. Both genders have been entirely Machiavellian throughout all of history. And if you're able to see that, then you have a repentant mind, okay? And the idea that feminists insisted that they're inherently perfect, women are inherently perfect, what they did was they demanded that all women accept this, because they couldn't tolerate some women saying, no, wait a minute, well, no. That's ridiculous. You know, we women have been just as Machiavellian as men throughout history. Feminists said, no, you can't say that. So they've demanded that all women accept this belief. And so they basically demand that all women be unrepentant. That no women can have a repentant mind in this world. And in fact, they claim that all women throughout history who've had a repentant mind were duped by men, and that they were actually suppressed and repressed and controlled by men as slaves. And that's how they view repentant mind throughout history. Amazing. But there are women who see through who do have a repentant mind. And they say, no. I don't want to buy into arrogance anymore. That's ridiculous. Totally insane. But they're under ungodly pressure to agree that women are inherently perfect. And therefore, they don't need to repent. If you're inherently perfect, why do you need to repent? As a gender, as a body, as a person. Okay. Repentance is all about recognizing, no, I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. That this whole play of existence as we've been experiencing as bodies is nothing but the play of arrogance. That's all that it is. It's a Machiavellian play of arrogance attempting to win and attempting to defeat God in a contest, actually. But women have been put under this intense pressure to believe that men are inherent liars, that they made up, that women are inherently perfect, that men have slandered them throughout history, that repentance is something that men made up to turn women into losers, to falsify and deceive women, that they believe that repentance is something that men have made up to deceive women into thinking that they're not the inherent winners and men are the inherent losers. And they think that all this history of religion is the inherent losers, which they think as men, scheming against women and making up this ridiculous pie-in-the-sky notion of salvation in order to make women have this mind of repentance, which they say is actually women having low self-esteem. You know, they call it low self-esteem. So this is what's called the war against religion, is really being led by the radical feminists. They're the ones that are behind this. Because they say that salvation is a devilish plot by men, targeting women's inherent perfection and winnerness, inherent winningness of women, to avoid the inherent loser status of men. This is 100% the play of arrogance. 100% the play of the logic of arrogance. Where arrogance has to have this dissociation into a dualism of good and bad arrogance, where there's a winner and a loser within arrogance. Okay, this is the only way that arrogance can play this game. So you have these two genders, male and female, and the play of arrogance has to see one as a winner and another as a loser. But the repentance doesn't need to see it that way. Repentance does not need to see it that way. Jesus admonished both men and women, go repent, go sin no more. There was no saying, well, one is inherent winners and others are inherent losers. Okay. Both have to repent, and both have to repent, and both have to minimize the Machiavellianness. And there's a way to do that. There's a way that can minimize the play of arrogance. And of course, feminists call this all a plot against women. This is their view of history, which is, you know, completely cuckoo. Completely cuckoo, and they're engaged in Machiavellianism. It's just amazing. Now, every single spokesperson that ever speaks now for any company or any bureaucracy or anything is a woman. I don't hear a single man now whatsoever ever talk in defending a institution at this point, except the Catholic Church, actually. I think that's one that still uses bishops speak up. It's the only one that I'm aware of. Even Protestants now use women as spokespersons to speak up to defend whatever they need to defend. Any corporation that's done wrong or whatever, it's always the woman is now the spokesperson. Women are elevated to positions like the Attorney General of California. You know, just boom, boom, boom. Well, the Attorney General of the United States is a woman. It has to be a woman. You see, we're following the logic of arrogance here that women are infallible. And if we just put those who are infallible in all the positions of power, that we're bound to have a millennium right now. And the dispensationalists in this world, who are Christians who believe in the millennium, a golden age of 1,000 years, they are dupes for this, actually. Because they know that from their viewpoint, we have to have people who are infallible in positions of power in the world in order to have a perfect society and governance. And then so this fits right in with the belief that women are infallible. If we just put them in all the positions of power over us, then we're bound to have a perfect world. This is the logic that is driving the future of this planet, actually. At one level. And then there's the cosmic schemes, Machiavellian schemes on a cosmic scale, which is the belief that ETs are infallible. And that we need to put them in position. So the ETs and the women, feminists, have made this deal. And the ET says, yeah, sure, we'll support you being in positions of power, and that will help. And then we'll help you, because we're infallible too. We're infallible on a grander scale, so we'll teach you about even greater infallibility. That not only are you infallible in this world, you're infallible in the entire cosmos, and we'll teach you how to do that, but you need to kind of share the power here. So there's all this Machiavellian trying to win on a grander scale now. This is what what's at play in this world. All the while, the losers are those who speak of repentance. This is seen as a devious, devilish plot against the infallibility of arrogance. And so what's happened is what we bemoan, my generation, we all bemoan the loss of common sense. And what common sense is really the mind of repentance, seeing that we're not trying to choose a winner between men and women. We're both losers in terms of arrogance is nothing but a loser. It's inherently, there's no way it can win. So it's inherently a losing scheme. So we need to repent. We need to accept our identity as spirit and not as body. This is common sense. My generation still had common sense, where we're not trying to pick an infallible male and infallible female winner between the genders. We say, hey, we're both sinners, and the women understand that. They have common sense to say, you know, what do you mean I'm perfect? I'm not perfect at all. I do all sorts of schemes and this, and I make mistakes all the time, and I'm trying to win here, and I know I do bad stuff, and I put, you know, this and this, and it's a Machiavellian dance. And they realized it. And the whole idea of going to confession, for instance, is to confess this to all the stuff I did where I put my husband down. I tried to put him in a bad light. I tried to make him look like a loser, you know, and the man says, yeah, you know, I tried to make my, you know, wife, put her down and tried to make her seem like a loser in certain ways too. And I tried to aggrandize myself too. Both realize that they're both doing this. They're both doing this. This is the culture of repentance. We don't have to find a winner. As we say, Jesus is the winner, meaning Christ consciousness is the winner, which means original nature is the winner, which means the way that God created us as spirit is the winner. That's the winner. It's not even a winner. It's beyond that, because it's impossible to be a loser. So this is eternal life. This is eternal life. Eternal life is my identity. This is the culture of repentance that we have lost, which has been attacked by radical feminism in concert with cosmic corporate culture, who both are driven by the logic of arrogance. The desperate need to prove themselves as infallible winners. Original nature is formless, is formless, is formless, is formless. As Jesus said, we are neither male nor female. Very important. So we bemoan the loss of this common sense. It is the worst thing that's ever befallen this world. 2,000 years or more of repentance swept away in a frenzy of arrogance. Now, what are some? There are various things that cause this, and it's too late now to do anything about it. But part of it was psychotherapy, where most of the people in therapy were women, actually, very intelligent women. And what psychotherapy did was they opened up this Pandora's box where we were able to see just how Machiavellian we really were. And women were appalled at what they saw, because they say if men realize just how Machiavellian we really are, they'll never love us or trust us again, which is true. And also, if women saw how Machiavellian men were, they'd never trust men either. So what happened was women became very frightened that the family unit would disintegrate. But keep in mind that psychotherapy was not based on repentance. Okay, it was not based on repentance. It was based on sort of wishful thinking. And it led women into a trap, actually. Very interesting. And they panicked. And they said, we don't dare let men know just what we found out about ourselves and history. Just how bad, evil we really have been throughout history. They realized it. They said, holy cow. We've really not been good at all. Which is true. None of history's been good. None of it's been right. It's all this Machiavellian dance of, you know, and women realize that we've been trying to make men appear to be the losers. You know, and men have been trying to make women appear like they're, you know, the losers too. But it's been a dance of winning and losing where there's been alliances. And so it's been a constant kaleidoscope and a mosaic of shifting kind of thing. So you can't pin anything on one gender at all, actually. But they were just freaked out and not having the tools of repentance. They said, we have to stonewall this whole thing. And so that flipped over into the infallibility of women, that all of history, men were the ones who were completely wrong, have lied about everything in history. That's what happened. You had all these women who were really into psychotherapy from the beginning. Most of the patients were women from the whole psychotherapy movement. And they pushed this, you know, they thought this was the cure, and they pushed it to the point where they opened up their psyche and saw what's really has been taking place, the arrogance, the inherent arrogance. They're extremely arrogant. Women are extremely arrogant, as are men. They saw the extreme of their arrogance and didn't have any tools to deal with it. Because they thought that religion was for stupid people. You know, they thought they were more too intelligent for that, really. Didn't need it. This was the modern age. And there's no way that anyone wouldn't panic if you don't have the tools of repentance. But again, all psychotherapy was based on a fallacy of this is a way to win. Okay, this is how you can be a winner. So the very motive for psychotherapy was, I need to win. I just don't feel like I'm winning. And I need to win. We've worked so hard to win throughout history. Women have worked so hard to win throughout history. There's no question about it. As have men. Both genders have absolutely worked themselves to the utmost throughout history to try and win. And sometimes they'll work together, sometimes they will work against each other. But the motive has been the same, to win. We've got to find a win. And they just said, you know what, we're so tired of this. So this, we have to win. Psychotherapy is our only hope. You know, we've tried repentance, and it doesn't seem to enable us to win that well. They didn't try it enough is the problem. They did not try it enough. Neither men nor women tried repentance enough. They didn't give it a thorough opportunity. Both. And so the wages of that is that there's continued arrogance. And what's happened is now the situation has gone where women who were the ones who saw their arrogance more clearly through psychotherapy freaked out and have claimed this status of infallibility. And then have now inherent then that men are inherent losers. The women are inherent winners, men are inherent losers. They're now having this doctrine of inherency, which is, you know, a complete absurdity. And the big lie, in other words, they jumped into the big lie. And this is what you have to avoid. But they're completely into it now. And history is completely into this, the big lie now, which is why we call it the end of the age, is... So the men who have not given repentance the full trying, you really been given an honest, a fair hearing, have not given repentance a fair chance, they are now trapped in this situation. And this is the tragedy of the times. Because they don't have the tools to get out of it. They don't have the tools of repentance, so they're now trapped in this. The whole world is now trapped in this, and other than the ones who have repented, who still have the mind of repentance. I'm not trapped in it. I don't feel trapped in it so much. I feel I have options. Because I trust in the tools of repentance. I believe that they're going to work and be successful and free me from the whole dance of arrogance, the Machiavellian dance of arrogance. I feel very convinced that I will be liberated from this. And there's no need for any winning, that there's no need for any losing, that what we are is inherently prior to this notion of winning and losing. That we are simply absolute bliss, absolute freedom, absolute peace, absolute creativity, and that can never be viewed from the perspective of winning and losing. It's impossible. So I gave repentance a fair chance. So I'm able to see, you know, history. I'm able to see what's happening in the world clearly and speak about it honestly. But I'm not going to be John the Baptist, you know, a trophy. No, that's not my purpose here in terms of losing my head, as it were. No, not going to agree to that whatsoever. Because the tools of repentance work, and everybody must use those tools of repentance. So we know what went wrong here. You have to factor in the extraterrestrials, because they're heavily involved in this, in supporting this notion of infallibility, because they want to break the mood of repentance in this world. And the feminists have agreed to go along with the extraterrestrial agenda of taking over this planet, because the extraterrestrials are not disagreeing with the feminist idea of they're infallibly right, because they're doing the work that they want to do, which is to break the whole mood of repentance on this planet and claim it's all a sham, so that we're without any of those tools, and therefore we're completely vulnerable then, freak out and become vulnerable to the extraterrestrials saying, oh, we need help from infallibility, and then extraterrestrials will seem to be infallible, you know, much greater than we are, and we'll think, oh, we must follow their advice now, and they're the winners. And of course, in order to have the winners, you have to have the losers. Winning is based on losing in arrogance. So we don't understand that it merely means our enslavement. So there's a lot of men who did not give repentance a real fair chance. They were too busy working their rear ends off trying to support their families. And the desperate efforts of women to feel like they're winners. You know, this whole thing, the status thing of women. You know, you see, like in houses and construction, we all know that if you're working in this industry, that it's women who make the decisions. Absolutely. Never trust a man who says, yeah, I think that I'll be happy with that. Because then you do it, and later on, you have to change it all. Because the women say, no. I don't want that. You become aware, when you work in dealing with homes, you become aware of who really calling the shots in the house. It's always the woman. And the man's job is just to go out and earn enough money so that the women can you know, redecorate, remodel, do these things, and keep up with what? Keep up with other women, because they feel like losers if they don't. So they're desperate to feel like winners, and the men are basically, in many ways, just slaves to provide the means so women can keep up with other women and not feel like losers. Of course, men many times say, hey, I don't want to keep doing this. I want to be a slave. And then they, you know, divorce the women. And women are very afraid of that. You know, so you know, just this whole thing about having to be a winner causes this terrible struggle between the genders and very difficult lives. And, you know, there's so much divorce right now. Epidemic. And there's divorce lawyers constantly advertising. And it's just a hideous situation. Where there's just this lack of repentance. So men oftentimes have not had the opportunity to work on repentance and give it a fair chance. They didn't have the opportunity to go into psychotherapy. They had to keep working to pay for their wives' psychotherapy. You know, so they didn't get into this panic mode as bad as women did of seeing, oh my God, now I'm confronted with my arrogance. What do I do with it? Oh my gosh, if my husband ever realizes how arrogant I really am, and how I'm just, you know, trying to use him to boost my own winning stat, feeling of being winning. I'm such an egotist, you know. He'll hate me. He'll leave me. He'll divorce me. Oh my gosh, I can't do this. For the sake of my children, I have to claim I'm infallible. You know, this is what happened. And the men really don't know what the heck's going on, and they've been unable to give repentance a fair chance in their lives. So they're completely vulnerable to what's happening. They don't have the tools to combat what's happening. All they do is you know, listen to talk radio and call up talk radio and say how terrible it is, but they don't have the tools to combat it. They say, well, we got to win this next election. They're getting completely submerged. They don't really understand that what the ideology is that's taking place here is the infallibility of women and the belief and they're caught up in this dispensational belief. Many religious men are very caught up in dispensational belief of millennialism. And all the evangelicals, you know, much of Christianity, the men are caught up in this belief. And this whole thing plays right into this belief of we need infallible people in all ruling over us, and they don't have the tool. They don't have the tools to combat the belief that women are infallible because they too are still trying to win, and winning and losing. They're caught up in this. They can't combat it. They don't have the tools. So all they do are basically, you know, they're just trudging to their, you know, destruction, as it were. It's amazing. You listen to men talk, they don't have any remedy. They say, well, yeah, we got to get the right candidates, but there are no right candidates. Wow. What are we doing? Oh, and they just complain about this thing, this thing, this thing, this thing. Ain't it awful? Ain't it terrible? This is the mood of someone who feels that they're inherently losing and there's nothing they can do except grouse about it. You know, they're trapped. They're trapped. The arrogance is a trap. And they believe they still have to win, but they don't have the, right now, the logic of arrogance has come up with the solution that the infallibility of women is the way to win. This is the logic of arrogance that is carrying the day. Okay. So as long as men keep buying into the logic of arrogance and not repentant, they can't help but be swept along by this logic of arrogance as it's playing out on this planet right now. This is the tragedy of the situation. So just because, you know, men have been working so hard just to minister the churches, to fund the churches, to work to build the churches, you know, all this effort they've been, it didn't leave them much time for actual contemplation, which is necessary. Now, women had more time, at least modern women. What happened was modern women got all these conveniences, which freed a lot of time up for them. Children away at college, and so they went into therapy. They said, wow, I can really work on myself now. And they had the money, they had the time, but men, no, not so much. And they felt, women felt, finally we're going to be able to win because we've got the time, we got the money, we got psychotherapy, and we're going to be able to win now. And then this led to this catastrophe of being confronted with seeing their arrogance and not having the tools of repentance they needed. Because let's be honest, also throughout history, all the churches, everyone attended church. I've attended church, you know, on and off, and I've been examining and observing everything for my whole life, observing. And what I observe is that it's a social function in a lot of ways. That women are there because they feel that being there helps them win. It's a social winning strategy. They're not really there to repent. So they really didn't have the tools of repentance either. You'd think that women who have attended church, you know, very religiously throughout history, they would be repentant. No. No, it was more a strategy of social winning, how to win. So neither women nor men have really given repentance a fair opportunity, a fair chance in their lives throughout history. Only those who, the nuns, the monks, those, even that was throughout history often a strategy of winning. Only those who are truly repentant, give, you know, truly desperate and willing to repent and give it a fair chance, those are the ones. And both men and women have done that throughout history. Some. And what they say is very different. And you don't see them being radical feminists or supporting radical feminism. You don't see those women who have truly repented supporting radical feminism at all. They're saying, no, sister, you need to repent. You need to repent. You can't pull this on me. I'm not going to buy into that. Of course, what women say is, hey, well, look, we'll make you like the goddess of this world if you just agree with our infallibility. And there's bound to be some woman come along who's going to play that role. They tried to get Ananda Mayanma to play that role, and she absolutely refused. It's a fact, historical fact, that they thought they had their goddess that they could, who was perfect, actually, but was the perfection of spirit, not the perfection of any gender. She said she never identified with her body, which means she never identified with the female gender at all, which is true, nor the male gender. No identification with genderness whatsoever. And so, but they said, hey, here's someone who really is infallible, and therefore, if we can get her to accept the position of goddess of this planet, which was what they tried to do in India, and that then we will be able to that our claim that we're inherently infallible as women will be able, that will carry the day, and we'll be able to institute this over the entire planet. Well, they did it anyway. They just didn't get her help in doing so. And they tried to prevent her from actually going to the men. And she actually snuck away from the women that surrounded her. She used all sorts of ways to manage to get to the men and tell them, too, you must repent. You must continue the path, Prince. I don't play any favorites. I'm not playing. She said, even though it seems like I'm playing favorites, that I'm favoring women, I'm not. But it certainly, the feminists tried to make it seem that this was true. And they tried to create this myth of these goddess women who are enlightened, are goddesses that they're inherently pro-women and are supporting the infallibility of women. That's a big lie, very big lie. It's not true. And Ananda Mayanma always said, was positive about everything, about the future, about this, is, you know, always benefit. There's nothing that's not going to benefit. Everything is going to benefit you. This is her perspective. So she said, well, the future, she did say women are going to take over. And she said, but this is going to have benefit to all. She always said everything is going to have benefit to all. But she was not speaking, she was speaking entirely from a motivational standpoint. So that she, basically what her point was, you have to have a viewpoint that everything is benefiting to you. Sure, her perspective was, view everything that happens to you as totally beneficial to you. Okay, so it was not a sociological statement that she made at all. It was completely spiritual. The context was entirely spiritual, that the way to be saved is to view everything as the grace of God, everything as beneficial, that no matter what happens, this, take it in a way that helps you awaken from your arrogance. So she would never say that, yes, this is how the future is going to go, and this is going to be very bad for you. She's not going to ever say such a thing. That was the way that she presented the discipline and motivation, etc. Now, there's another way you can say that no matter what happens in this world, the dance of arrogance is never good. It's never good. It's never what you want. It will never give you what you want. This is the netty, 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 sort of, it's not this, not this, not this, not this. I tend to sort of be both ways. But I see it as, you know, the future is extremely ill-suited for everyone. But, of course, if you're going to be in the future, you have to believe that you have to, whatever happens, you have to turn it into grace to awaken you from arrogance. So you have to have somewhat of a positive feel about it, I guess. But some, you know, the Judeo-Christian tradition is often is that this world is, Jesus points out, there's nothing in this world that I want. Nothing that I want. And this is another way of doing it. It sort of marked the spirit of Ananda Maimon's mission here, that she was a supportive, affirming, always supportive, always affirming, always keep a positive outlook, you know, always, and this helps you, it helps you work on repentance better if you always have this positive outlook. So she refused to criticize the future, but she absolutely said that women are going to take over, no question about it. But again, she refused to criticize anyone for any reason, except somebody who was wearing the robes of a monk just to get free rides on a train. She said, "Look, that gives a bad cast to everybody." So she would admonish, but she wouldn't really criticize. So we cannot say that someone who refuses to criticize anything is endorsing anything either. It's not an endorsement. You see, non-duality is not an endorsement of this world at all, of arrogance. But they refuse to get caught up in this play of criticism. See, they refuse to do that. So that there is wisdom behind that. But it's easy to take it then, to easily to twist that here in the West and then to think that women are infallible. They could fall into this arrogant trap. It's very easy. So I don't know how to exactly, you know, it's... How to go along with that is a very tricky situation indeed. And because arrogance demands losers, you know. This is what I've seen without any, very clearly. And in fact, its winning is based on losing, is predicated on losing. So the idea that somehow the future is going to be successful because it has to be because we've identified an infallible class of losers, an infallible loserness. Okay. It has to be. Also keep in mind that Ananda Mayama said that everything that she said that you've put into my mouth, I don't have any agenda whatsoever. So she said, I'm only speaking the words that you have put a request of me, so to speak. I don't have an actual agenda here. And then she also said, leave me out of it, in terms of, don't try to cite me as some authority or something like that. So she, you know, was very vague about being pinned down, and you could not pin her down in any way whatsoever as to what she was really supporting. Because really she was supporting that which is beyond conceptuality. The true infallibility of truth, of reality, that cannot be seen or approached, actually. You cannot approach it. You can only realize that you are it. You can't approach it. It's not approachable. So there's this intentional dance that she danced that you couldn't pin her down on anything. So you cannot really cite this, you know, one way or the other. You cannot cite it one way or the other. And so we just let it be as it is. What was this helpful dance there? Okay, and we just say, okay. Let the help, whatever help there was from that, let it, you know, it will be helpful. And we need to also get help accept all the help that we can accept here. And from my perspective in helping out, I see how the Machiavellianness of arrogance, and I see how it's designed to produce a loser. And in order to produce a loser, you need to assert a priori, there's this assertion that there's an inherent infallible winner that therefore produces the loser, that the loser becomes a loser because there's nothing they can do to unseat this infallible winner, and they get trampled underfoot by this. They can't win. So how to do that within arrogance is to state that women are infallible. That's how arrogance has come up. This is the remedy that arrogance has come up with. And since if we don't have the tools of repentance, we have no choice but to follow what arrogance is advising us. We have no choice. And the millennialists are just hoping that putting women in all these positions of power is going to somehow miraculously produce this golden age in the world. And we dwell here as bodies, as men and women, still believing we're bodies, okay? But just that we'll have some, this miraculous golden age, we'll all be happy. And this is, you know, the logic of arrogance entirely. So you don't see this groundswell in this world of saying, wait a minute, I want to sidestep this. I don't want to be part of this. I don't want to be part of this winning and losing dichotomy. What I was told by the radical feminists is that I could, if I supported them, I would be the sort of honorary female, so to speak, where I wouldn't be, this loser status would not be attached to me, you know. That sort of, you know, you could, you know, those who helped them rise to power like this would then they'd be sort of recognized as, well, there's a sort of subclass of men that are not, that are honorary women, so to speak. But you inhabit this twilight zone where you're neither a man nor a woman. You're an honorary female, so to speak, honorary woman. This is what I was told and promised. And of course, you know, they broke their promises entirely. What I found out is they absolutely plan on completely trampling you and throwing you in the garbage dump. This is just a promise they made, expedient promise that arrogance was made. Say, well, what do we do, you know, with the men who are really intelligent? Well, you know, we tell them that they can be seen as infallible too. But I said, well, wait a minute, the men are inherently losers and liars, and women are fallible. How can I attain the status of women? Well, you can be an honorary woman or something.
Yeah.
And a lot of men now are thinking about sex change operations so they can become a female, like Bruce Jenner did. This is what's driving it, actually. They say, well, how can I be infallible if I'm a man? It's not possible. So they're saying, well, yeah, you have to change your gender now. But even then, they'll say, well, you did it through deceit, you know. They didn't keep their promise, and I realized that this. Hey, wait a minute! I said this is I'm being lied to. I'm being lied to here. So I said, no way! I'm seeing through this. What's going on? Because what they really say is, well, maybe you can do this. Maybe this might be okay with me, but of course. Later on, some more harsh, you know, once they get this infallible status, they say, no, we've changed our mind. And since we're infallible, we have the right to change our minds. A woman's prerogative to completely change their mind about anything they want. You run into this in construction where a woman says, I want this bathroom tiled this way. And then later on, when you finish, it comes back and says, I don't really like that. I want you to change it and tile it this way. Okay, change it. Come back and say, nah, that's still not it. I want you to, I have a better idea. I want you to do this. And of course, they want you to do it all, these changes under the original bid, which was just to do it this one way, which they decided upon. And when you say, well, I got to charge you for the materials and the hours, I say, what? You crazy? What a deceitful man you are. I mean, what a bad man you are. If you want to be a winner, you know, you got to prove to me you're a winner, which is by don't charge me anything for all these changes, which is what? Slavery. So what they're really saying to men, if you want to be ultimately be a winner, you have to be a slave. And this is the path to being a winner, is being a slave. Of course, it's really what they think is the path for them being winners, which is to be able to win at designing the world they want through arrogance, being a body, believing that, so they need to keep changing the tile in their bathroom, keep remodeling their bathrooms. They'll remodel the bathroom a million times if they felt they could, if women felt they could get free remodels on their homes, that men would do it for free, and that the women would do all the labor, buy all the materials, do everything, and they didn't have to pay a penny. They would be constantly remodeling their homes and their yards and everything, constantly, never stop. This is their dream. This is what they believe they're going to be able to get. That women, men will work for free. This is the pressure that men are under, actually. I'm directly aware of this pressure, is that men are supposed to work for free. And what's happening, for instance, in the construction industry, is that they're pulling, the reason why we have all this illegal immigration taking place, is this is causing extremely cheap labor in construction, which enables the women to do much more remodeling than they could before, by paying incredibly, have it done incredibly cheap, basically for cost. That construction people are doing jobs for cost right now. They're not even making any profit. And this cheap labor is coming in and subverting the ability to earn a decent wage here. It's an extreme problem. And yet there's a massive amount of remodeling and building going on. But it's being much of it, there's just a lot of illegality taking place, paying cash, not having workman's compensation for this super cheap labor that is being employed here in this world. And so they're able, and so the goal, what they really want is to get it done for free. And the clients, many of them feel they don't have to pay. They shouldn't have to pay. The mindset now from these women is that we shouldn't have to pay you. It should be an honor for you to work for us. You're helping support our infallibility. You're helping prove our infallibility. This is your role. They see the role of men is now that proving the infallibility of women. They see that men are inherent losers. They carry all the guilt of being liars and deceivers throughout history, and that the only way to expiate this guilt that they have is to support women's, prove that women are infallible. And women tell them, well, if you do that, maybe you'll get rid of some of the guilt that you have. That's the only way. It's the only way. And so they're really going towards men simply being chattels, slaves, doing free labor for them. Absolutely, I can testify for this. This is exactly what is happening. I mean, I've had this directly happen to me. I did all this work, and I said, well, you know, where's my money? They said, what? Oh, we thought you were just doing this just, you know, to be a nice guy. And they were incredulous. I said, well, we thought you were a nice guy. I mean, a good guy. This good guy is code for slave. A good man is code for slave right now, actually. We thought you were a slave. We thought you were trying to get rid of your guilt. We thought you were trying to be salvation. We thought you were a religious person. You believe in salvation. Well, we know what salvation is. You have to get rid of your guilt. You're the one who's carrying the guilt. You're the one who lied about all history, who portrayed women in less than an infallible light. And we know now that was all a lie. And so you have all this guilt on you. And so you have to work to get rid of that guilt. And the only way to get rid of that guilt is you have to work for us, because you slandered us. You're the ones who slandered us all throughout the beginning, from Adam and Eve. And the Pope has now agreed with all this, that Adam and Eve was a male slander. That actually it was Adam that was at fault and not Eve. So the Pope has completely agreed with what's happening in the world now. Amazing, huh? I heard that and I was so upset about that. I said, wow. This is what's going on. There's no question about it. So, of course, men are afraid to leave this planet because they think the only way of salvation is to work off their guilt towards women. Now, I don't have this type of guilt towards women at all, because I realize I've seen what's really gone on. And there's equal guilt to view. And actually, the guilt is really just the guilt of arrogance. That's all it is. So there's no way you need to work off guilt. You need to repent and drop arrogance. That's the only remedy there is. Nothing has ever happened to anyone here that wasn't their own desire and belief that this is what they wanted to experience. And all of that derives from spiritual arrogance. Not the arrogance of women, not the arrogance of men, but spiritual arrogance is the problem. Men and women are merely symbols that are being used by spiritual arrogance. Camouflage. That spiritual arrogance is camouflaging itself by pretending that this dance of men and women and bodies, etc., is causative, that's what's happening. It's not. These are just dream symbols. Men and women have never done anything, actually. It's only spirit that's done all of this. It's only spirit that's done all of this. It's only spiritual arrogance that's the problem. That's it. And so we need the tools to get free of spiritual arrogance. Those are the tools of repentance. Those are the tools that the great teachers give us. So as long as we try to solve it at the level of bodies, we're trapped in arrogance. And we will end up following the advice, the logic of arrogance, which comes to us as advice that we feel. Either it comes from within us as some kind of revelation. Oh my gosh, I'm an infallible woman. Or it comes to us as some God, you know, that's telling us, you must do this, you must do this. You know, they follow these rules and regulations or laws or something. There's various different ways. Either it comes from the God or the goddess, either externally or internally. But it's still all just defense systems, arrogance defending itself. Arrogance refusing to repent. Spirit refusing to repent. Because why? Continuity fear and fear of annihilation. Okay. So seeing this, what I'm sharing is the tools of repentance, right spiritual practice, how to practice successfully, what the tools are, how to use the tools. You need to be a spiritual carpenter, a spiritual construction worker, a spiritual redesigner, so to speak. Right? And the only way to redesign spiritually is to repent. That's the only way. There isn't any other way. Your spirit, you're free. You're still spirit exactly as God created you to be. You're not a body. So we have gone through in my lifetime, the last almost 60 years, is just this incredible, humongous upheaval and a devastating, tragic loss of the mood of repentance, which played out in this world as common sense. Men could criticize women, women could criticize men, and they both understood that that neither one of them is lily white at all. And there wasn't any attempt to pretend otherwise. And there was also a mutuality there saying, hey, look, we're both screwed up. Let's go to church. Let's see if we can find the tools of repentance. Let's see if we can find the tools of repentance. We both need to. This was common sense. This was the culture. I know that people who still have that mood of repentance, if they come into this modern world, somehow if they're isolated, they come into it, they're astonished. They're astonished. Especially the women are astonished. They say, what in the heck is going on here? They're just dumbfounded by it. And then, of course, they see all the material advantages now that women say, well, I can redecorate my, I can redo, I can remodel, I can get a new car, I can get all this. I can be the call the shots, you know, be the governor, the mayor, the president, I can be the head of the corporation. I can sue anybody for anything. I can, you know, extort, blackmail. I can make false allegations. I can demand that men are slaves. I can do it. They say, wow, that's kind of evil, but you know, I can get all this dressed like a goddess, and I can walk around. Everybody will bow to me. And I said, "Wow, that's like really evil, but it's like really tempting too." Yeah. And this is Eve. You know, this is pointing out the fallacy of this notion that women are infallibly perfect, and neither are infallibly perfect. You know, Adam was also to blame for going along with Eve. You know, it's a duality. Right? You can't lay it all on Eve. You can't lay it all on Adam. You have to lay it on Spirit. Okay. which the Pope has refused to do. The Pope is really a piece of work. He's an absolute tool, patsy for this. He is not, as is the president. These two people are patsies for what's going on. They're the ones who are allowing it to take place. They could stand up and speak up, and instead they chose not to. Instead they supported it all, and subverted, you know, common sense, and that we both need to repent. That spiritual repentance is the responsibility of everyone on this planet. There's no such thing as the infallible male. There's no such thing as the infallible female. There's only the infallible spirit, which is only revealed by us setting down spiritual arrogance, which is an attempt to be greater than God. This is the gospel. This is being the good shepherd. Pope is not being a good shepherd. The president is not being a good shepherd. All the while pretending that they're leading us into some, you know, awesome millennial experience. And once you lose this common sense mood of repent, it's very difficult to get it back again. Once it becomes institutionalized, once arrogance becomes institutionalized, which is what's taking place now, which is what the extraterrestrials are engaging in, institutionalizing this arrogance on this planet to an extraordinary extent, it is very difficult to get it back again. That's why Jesus talked about the end of the church age. The end of the age will come, and that we're at it now. This is when Jesus returns, and I say he's already returned. How come I know? Because my attention is on spiritual repentance, which is where Jesus tells us to put our attention on. Okay. We're not trying to work it out between the genders. We're realizing that it's arrogance is spiritual, not human arrogance. It's spiritual arrogance, which is you have to resolve it spiritually. Not through gender politics. So, I don't fear Jesus at all. I don't feel that he's going to, you know, put me down and try to throw male guilt onto me, gender politics me with male guilt. I don't feel that way. If he tried to, I'd certainly reject it. But I've never got that feeling from him at all. And in spite of me speaking up vehemently about this, I've never felt any rejection from Jesus. In fact, I've met with him several times recently, and there's not the slightest feeling of rejection of me. So that would indicate he's not going along with the gender politics of the times. That he's not deceived by it. Not deceived by it. I've also had meetings with other teachers and not been rejected by them either. So, I feel I'm on the right track. That repentance is 100% spiritual. That all arrogance is spiritual. And it's not to be that the attempt to pin it on bodies and genders is a camouflage, is a defense, is a severe defense, defending arrogance. So this whole thing of radical feminism is a severe defense of arrogance by pinning the guilt on men in this way. And of course, because that this is what their goal was, to pin all the guilt on men, and they felt so guilty about this. Oh my gosh, you know, what they did, they projected it and said, no, it's men that have been pinning guilt on women all throughout history. All we're doing is we're, you know, pointing this fact out, you know. No, That's not their goal. Their goal was to pin all the guilt, the loser status on men. Plain and simple. Because historically, again, reading history, men did not pin all the guilt on women. In fact, they pin more guilt on themselves. They're very harsh critics of themselves. And usually men take way more blame. You know, like the man, you know, it demands, like, you know, like, for instance, Herod demanding the execution of John the Baptist. What a tyrant, what a hideous, you know. But the full story was he got trapped. He got trapped into, you know, to doing this. That doesn't make him blameless, you know. And oftentimes, if you dig deeper throughout history, you find that the men who act in a very tyrannical way, oftentimes there's Machiavellian, tremendous amount of intrigue and Machiavellian stuff swirling around from their wives, their sisters, their mothers, the female influence in there is constantly trying to figure out, how can we win? How can we win? Oh, if we can use this strong man to, you know, force winning upon this situation, then this will help us win. So it's absolutely actually, the situation is so bad that men have to struggle, make sure that they don't try to pin on women all the guilt too. You know, because it seems that men are easily controlled by women throughout history. But it's also men's desire to win that makes them vulnerable to being manipulated this way, you see. That it's a blindness that men are easily tricked and deceived by women because they themselves feel like they see an opportunity to win, and the women can easily manipulate men once they're in that mindset of winning, and tilt them in a direction to apply this forceful attempt to win, to apply it in the direction that they want. You know, and then men say, wait a minute, you know, I got deceived by the women, you know, and they say, doggone women, they fooled me again. This is the dance of history. So men have to repent, there's no question too. Both men and women do. And men need to realize that they get easily manipulated to just be the slaves of women and carry out the women's designs, what women think will be winning, which oftentimes backfire on men. It's backfired, almost constantly backfire. And then men have to be the scapegoats of it. You know, they end up oftentimes being the scapegoats. But in history, the strong men, you know, when they found out they've been manipulated and lied to and deceived by women, you know, they would then execute the women, you know, basically. So the women paid a price back at that time for it. And so the arrogance that is playing through this play is saying, hey, wait a minute, if we can just make sure that women don't ever pay the price for their mistakes, you know, their manipulation of men, then we can be happy, and we can then claim infallible status, you know. So they're trying to say that women are always right, can never be punished for any mistakes they make, never have to be responsible for whatever they do. And so they can go into these corporations and run them into the ground and then just waltz away and then run for president or something. You know, like, you know, no, it's all, I didn't do anything wrong. I don't have to bear any responsibility for my actions whatsoever. It's like utopia. No, don't have to bear any responsibility for any of my actions. Of course, I need the slaves to clean up the mess constantly. You know, and it's amazing the Teflon that they have now. Like Hillary Clinton, you know, it's just utterly Teflon by people who've lost their common sense and are engaged in this attempt of when women are infallible, can do no wrong. Doesn't have to bear any blame or any responsibility for anything that she's involved with. Doesn't matter what she does. And if you take these people and say, give me, like, people who, for instance, are very supportive of the progressive and the president, and for instance, saying, okay, great, give me a list of 10 reasons, 10 things that the president could do where you would stop supporting them. Absolutely say, no, I'm never going to support you again. That because you did this, I realize that you've crossed the line. Okay, 10 ways that this president could absolutely cross the line and not support anymore. And I guarantee you they couldn't come up with even one. Even one. This is their mindset. That these they're going towards infallibility. And I've never heard anyone ask them that question, but this would stop them in their tracks, and it would expose what's really going on. So instead of going back and forth and arguing, you know, who's right, just say, wait a minute, okay, I can give 10 reasons why I wouldn't support a candidate. You know, like let's say there's some candidate, and I'd say, well, I could easily say, if they did this, I'd say no. If they did this, I'd say, forget it, you're out. But their candidates, I very much see that they're believing in infallibility, and they cannot give you even one reason that they would stop supporting. You know, in other words, if those who are voting in the progressive way, they would vote the progressive way even if their candidate decided to kill all babies in the whole world. They would still support them. They would say, well, my candidate is infallible, so there must have been some the babies must have been guilty, and this must be, it doesn't matter, they're still infallible. There's nothing that they can do that would get their supporters to stop supporting them. Nothing whatsoever. This is how Hitler rose to power. You know, this is the doctrine of infallibility. The arrogance has to go in this direction, and so this gets pinned on certain groups right now. It's being pinned on women now, actually, and those who support women. The current president of the United States is absolute mama's boy. Didn't even have a father, basically. A father abandoned the woman, I think, when she was still pregnant, and so he's basically raised by women, and he's controlled by women, and he does what women tell him to do. That's why he's in power, plain and simple. Plain and simple. There's no other way he could have risen to power except he is simply doing what women tell him to do. Radical feminists are telling him what to do. Doesn't have any backbone of a true man at all. Absolutely not. Doesn't have that common sense. It says, hey, wait a minute. You know, I'm not going to do that. Forget it. What do you mean you're telling me I have to do that? You know, who are you to tell me to do that? I'm not going to. I have my own mind. I have my own mind. I'm not infallible. Neither are you. We'll let the repentance of God, you know, be our salvation. Not this, I'm better than you, or you, I'm always right, or you're always right. That's not our salvation. You know, he doesn't have it. He doesn't have it. He's not a real man at all. He's a mama's boy. He's a controlled by radical feminists, by women. It's obvious, totally obvious. And again, but he's riding on the coattails of this infallibility thing. It's like, you know, a drug to him. Like, you know, wow, I can feel infallible. No matter what I do, I don't have to pay any consequences at all. Wow, that sounds like nirvana, utopia. And it's just absolutely mind-boggling to those who have some common sense that Hillary Clinton would even be considered as a candidate for president. It's just like impossible to believe. It's like a joke. Totally incompetent for the job. Has never shown any competence for it. Totally corrupt. An extreme liar and deceiver. Very, very vicious radical feminist. A supreme ideologue in her own infallibility and infallibility of women. Extreme hater of men. You know, to even remotely suggest that this person is qualified to be president, you know, 30, 40 years ago, this would be absolutely laughed away as a complete jest. And yet now people are taking it as some infallible truth that must happen. This is how far we've gone down the rabbit hole of losing common sense. It's a joke. It's for those who have repentance and common sense. It's an absolute joke. But they're not joking at all. They believe that they don't have to pay any consequences for whatever they do. They can simply decree this, this, and everybody is supposed to instantly jump and support them, do exactly what they ask. And if you don't, you're warring, have a war against women. Where is the war really coming from? The war is against men, actually. The war is to say that men are guilty of everything, women are infallible, and that men, the only way that men can expiate their terrible, endless sin of not recognizing, refusing to recognize women's infallibility from the beginning and warring against it from the beginning, is to be slaves of women and do whatever women ask them to do without any back talk whatsoever, and to not ask anything for it. In other words, being a complete slave. This is their ideology. Women smack their fingers, you know, and you know, it's back to off with their heads. So we're going back to that very clearly, off with their heads mentality in this world. Where else does arrogance, where else can arrogance go? Arrogance just keeps going around in circles. It can never get free of itself. It can never get free of itself. It reaches a certain point and then it lapses back. You know, it reaches a point where recognizing, oh, I'm really arrogant, but I don't know what to do about it. Oh my gosh. And then it goes, it just keeps going around in circles. You know, psychotherapy, you got this, oh, we're super arrogant, but oh my gosh, I don't know what to do about it. You know, then immediately collapsing back into what's the same old, same old. It just goes around and around in circles like this. And the instructive point of all this is seeing this. We're all going to be made slaves of the extraterrestrials. Actually, that's their agenda. See, there's a bigger cosmic agenda, which is to make this whole planet a vassal slave state, a colony, a slave colony. that's a bigger trap. Now, if Jesus came back and said, look, I have prepared a place for you like I promised, and I'll take you there, who would go there? The fact of the matter is that we're so caught up in this belief in guilt now, male guilt, women and female infallibility, that what woman would want to leave this planet thinking that, wait a minute, here in this planet I can be viewed as infallible now. I will be viewed as infallible, never have to pay a consequence for anything I do, that men will be my slaves, and I don't have to pay, you know, they'll be like dogs, like on the status of a dog, and they'll be my slaves, and I'll train them, I'll do exactly what I want to do, they'll make robots for me. You know, why the heck should I leave this planet? And the men will say, hey, wait a minute, I'm totally guilty, I've totally slandered women throughout history, I'm a horrible, terrible person, and the only way I can ever get rid of this guilt is to make amends with the women, and the only way I can do that is to serve them and not ask anything from them, and somehow I might be able to finally expiate and atone for this horrible, horrible guilt that I have, and that's the only way I can ever work out of being this inherently evil and wretched, terrible male person. So if I leave this planet and go to some place where I don't have this opportunity to be a slave for women in perpetuity, there's no way I can ever get rid of this guilt. So I'm not going to go. I mean, I don't want to be stuck with this guilt. So you see that Jesus is coming back, and if he does have a place for us, who's going to go? Who's going to go? Who's going to go? Is this still working? Yeah. My gosh, seems like I've been talking for a lot longer than this, but maybe because it's so intense. Who's going to go? Who's going to go? And if almost nobody goes, doesn't that throw up the proposition and say, hey, wait a minute, if this really were such a good deal, everyone would be going there. So it must not be a good deal. So what I'm showing you is, even if it was a perfect deal for us, very few would go here, because only the repentant would go, who see through the scam of guilt that arrogance has put upon us, of winner and loser, and that the loser needs to, you know, expiate their guilt, and the winner has the right to indulge in their winning status and to see the losing status. And this is all the logic of arrogance. And to see through the logic of arrogance, and you realize, oh, wow, this is all nonsense here. There's no escaping with the logic of arrogance, has no escape velocity within it whatsoever. It just continues to misplace guilt and play this game of guilt. Play this game of guilt, which always involves then winners and losers, slavery, you know, infallibility. I should be, you know, have no consequence. Well, I can do anything I want. I can abuse anyone I want, and there's no consequence. Very nasty game that is being played in this world. Very, very nasty. And it's being played to the hilt right now. And the ends justify the means for arrogance. So arrogance is vicious in the type of hardball that it plays in trying to attach guilt to one side, and you're the loser, and no guilt to the other side, you're the winner. Instead of no guilt for anyone, just spiritual arrogance. See, spiritual arrogance refuses to recognize that it's what it is and set it down. So it insists that there is guilt, but it just tries to pin the guilt on some group and say, you're the guilty ones. This is a duality, okay? This never works. It never frees us from arrogance at all. Because truly, the fact is that guilt is impossible for anyone, because we're all perfectly free, and everything that we're experiencing, we're choosing. We're total sovereigns of our experiencing. So it's completely impossible for any wrong to ever be done to anyone. But arrogance never can see it this way, because arrogance claims that reality isn't perfect, that we're not perfectly free, that we're not perfectly choosing our experiencing, that there are things that happen to us. And so there are wrongs that can happen to us, and it's not our fault, and therefore there is guilt. And you see, this is the logic of arrogance, and it's impossible for the logic of arrogance to free itself. You can't use the logic of arrogance to get free of the logic of arrogance. It's impossible. You have to use the reason of the Holy Spirit. You have to use the reason of the Holy Spirit, which is not the same as the logic of arrogance. The reason is very logical, but it doesn't have the same premise as the logic of arrogance has, which the premise is that reality isn't perfect, and that there's this contest taking place to determine, you know, what is perfect and what isn't perfect. Nothing but arrogance. It's not true. It's a lie. So the situation is so extreme, I don't even know if I would go with Jesus. I don't know. I can't say that I would or I wouldn't. I don't know. Because this fear that if you leave this planet, that your opportunity for repentance will be gone. The opportunity to get rid of guilt, you won't have it. Because the whole way this situation is set up now is we think we've identified who the guilty party is, and therefore we think that we've identified who the blameless party is, and therefore we know what kind of punishment needs to be met out, and what kind of atonement needs to be undertaken. And so we think we have a roadmap to utopia now on this planet. You see? So that's very seductive, what's happened here. And this is something that is very... We have this nervousness about it. I've been trying to burn my bridges to the future of this planet. Trying to burn my bridges, and I've done, you know, I keep working at this. Otherwise, you're likely to reject any offer of sanctuary. And then sour grape it and say, no, I made the right move, because those that take sanctuary, they're not going to have any opportunity to repent, to work off their guilt. They'll be stuck with it. You see, and so they'll sour grape the whole thing. There's already the drum beats on that are very strong. That our religion is just a myth. All this is mythical. It's crazy. There's no opportunity there, you know, to get rid of your, to work off your guilt. You know, it's like being an indentured servant. You're told, oh, yeah. It's kind of like, you know, you'll be put in a position where you've taken a massive loan and you're only alive from the grace of the infallible ones. But if you work long enough and hard enough and please the infallible ones, eventually you might be able to work off your debt. But the interest is so high, of course, that you never work it off. And ultimately, there's rebellion from that, and the thing flips again. But the way things are set up, men are going to be, you know, perpetually enslaved. The way that it's set up now, the idea is perpetual enslavement of men. The men will be like dogs, lower than dogs, actually. Because we're actually treating dogs way better than men will be treated in the future. And in fact, dogs are the new companions of women, if you notice that. You look at the way women are obsessed with dogs now, and they're really treating dogs like dogs are their new companions, because they view men as not fit to be their companions anymore, actually, and that the only role that men have is to help them redecorate their lives for free and do whatever labor is necessary without any complaint, and bowing and scraping and smiling, thank you, Goddess, I'm so privileged, it's my honor to do this for you. This is the attitude in construction. This is the attitude you need to have now, that you say, "Oh my gosh, it's such an honor for me to work here for you," and just you have to like stumble all over yourself, say, "My gosh, I can't believe how fortunate I am to even be doing this work for you for free," and I just so hope that you're pleased by it. My gosh, I just hope you're pleased. And they say, "Yeah, you did a pretty good job. Yeah, I'm happy." Oh, thank you. This is literally the attitude you have to have now. I mean, I'm literally experiencing all this. I can tell you all sorts of stories, amazing stories of these divas who, you know, just have men working for them constantly. And they're never satisfied. You know, spend a year re-landscaping the art, and then the next year says, you know what? I think it'd be, you know, I need to make some adjustments. And so another year, another, it goes endlessly, it goes on and on. I think I need to change this. Because they never feel truly infallible. And so they want their environment to reflect this infallibility. But always within the context of being a body, and within the context of arrogance, within the context of impermanence, within the context of a contest, within the context of having to have a loser. See, so it never feels right. The house never feels right. The yard never feels right. The social functions never feel right. It never feels perfect. The winning never feels complete. And so always, they say, no, something is wrong. I want it changed. I want it changed now. I want it changed yesterday. And I don't want to have to pay for it in the slightest bit. I shouldn't have to pay for anything because I'm infallible. And of course, arrogance says if the men don't do that, they say, well, then the women won't feel infallible. Which means that we haven't got a winner. And so this will all continue on. So there's an effort to try to bring this to a conclusion, you see, through arrogance. Arrogance can never bring itself to a conclusion. Never. And it just goes on hideously, like as history has always taken place. The history of this planet is hideous. This is arrogance. Arrogance can never bring itself to a conclusion. And the more it tries to do so, the more hideous the results are. So again, our fear is that leaving this planet, we will lose the opportunity. And I don't hear hardly anybody, almost zero people in the world talking about going to a refuge, a sanctuary that Jesus has prepared and living there with him. That seems like disappeared from the planet, this talk. Used to be that there was quite a bit of talk about that, actually. Because people now are very frightened of that option, thinking that somehow they're going to be deprived of the opportunity to be saved. That somehow this deprives them the opportunity to expiate their sin, their guilt. Of course, Jesus' teaching, very explicitly made clear in A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, and to some extent his ministry in Judea, is that there is no sin, there is no guilt to expiate. Doesn't exist. It's a fantasy. Now, if you go to a place where you're in bliss and perfection, and keep this in mind, everybody will be happy there. Now, in here, you know, men are like men who believed in this, going off the logic of arrogance, they believe they are guilty. So they think we have to work it off. How do we work it off? Well, we have to have these women who are unhappy about their bathroom so we can change it for them. So if we go to a place where everybody's happy and women say, it's perfect. I don't need to change a thing. You know, and we still have this guilt complex. We'll say, whoa, wait a minute, goddess. No. Let me do something for you. I got to, you know, let me, you know, you're happy with your dress and your flowers. And everything. No. Let me pick some flowers for you. It's not good enough for you. And they say, if they said, no, it's perfect for me. And we said, no, how can I work off my guilt if everything's perfect for you? You see how that works? So we're terrified of a place. And if the women went there and the men were saying, no, everything's perfect. I don't need to make anything better. They say, whoa, wait a minute. No. I need a loser. I need to, in order to win, I need to see a loser. A lot for the logic of errors. In order to be infallible, I need to see someone who's infallible. I need to see that you're not happy. I need to feel that you feel that you're guilty in order to, you know, keep giving me evidence that I'm a winner. So they would say, no, I don't like this place. So both the men and women who believe in guilt and arrogance, the logic of arrogance, would look at a perfect place and say, no. There's no way to win here. There's no way to win here. So how can Jesus, you know, quote unquote, get through to us? You know, he makes a place of perfection. Perfect nature's perfect there. Where you say, this is perfect. Just the way it is, it's perfect. The whole notion of looking, seeing, having this vision that says, you know what, everything's perfect, just the way it is, freaks out arrogance, absolutely freaks out arrogance. It says, what are you talking about? We need a winner. In order to have a winner, we got to have a loser. You can't just say everything's perfect the way it is. That's crazy. That's insane. Totally insane. There's no chance for salvation that way. This is how arrogance views it. So even if Jesus does have a perfect place for us, a sanctuary, the logic of arrogance, to the extent that we're trapped in that, we would reject it. We would reject it. No doubt about it. No two ways. We would absolutely reject it. I mean, I have been preaching sanctuary and refuge for a long time now. And I really have had almost no response. And I would say to Jesus, nobody was going to go there with you. I'll go there with you, but I don't think that there's a lot of people are going to go there. You know, it's inexorable. The logic of arrogance is a vicious tyrant. It's an inexorable tyrant. Jesus calls this logic of arrogance the ego. At least did call it that way, starting out to. So it would dovetail with the psychotherapeutic era that he was first started out. You know, of course, in Miracles came into the psychoanalytical era here, where we believe that was our salvation. But he must have known that what was going to happen here. which was exactly what has happened, exactly what I knew was going to happen, which is exactly what I was warned would happen. It has happened exactly as I was warned by the Holy Spirit. So, you know, it's interesting because if nobody goes, then we're going to call Jesus a liar, basically. Because nobody goes, nobody can testify to it. Actually, I've already been, and I've already seen, and I can testify to it. I was taken in spirit there and saying, wow, this is like just wow. What can you say? It's perfect. I don't want to change anything here. I just feel like just let everything just be the way that it is. I don't have to remodel anything here. So this whole demand for remodeling is a dance of guilt between men and women, actually, that's taking place constantly. Is both feel that something has to be done in order to get rid of this feeling of guilt to produce an ultimate winner here. So the women have to make demands, the men have to have demands made upon them, you know, that kind of thing. And if we just said everything's perfect, you know, how can we come up with a winner? You know, cannot. So this is the way why things always are continuing to go on here the same. The more things change, the more they are the same. There's a very good witticism that somebody put forth, whether maybe it's Oscar Wilde or Gertrude Stein or someone, said the more things change, the more they stay the same. The more things change, the more they stay the same. It's not like we don't recognize what's going on. There have been people throughout history, you know, and you yourself have probably recognized it. You get a glimpse of, hey, I see it. We just don't have the tools to get free of it. We feel we don't have the tools. And repentance, it is the tool. There are tools of repentance. And you have to become adept at using them. Just like if you're a construction worker, you have to become very adept at using the tools. The chop saw, the skill saw, the nail guns, the level, the tape measure. The compound miter saw. The table saw. You have to become adept at using those. Otherwise, you're going to have a very tough time building a house. It's going to be a great struggle for you. But once you become adept at using those tools, you can knock out a house. It's not a problem. It's not a problem. You can do any ripping you need to do on a table. So whatever you need to do with the lumber, with the material you have, you got the power tools to do it, and it's not a problem. So once you're adept at using the tools of repentance, path of repentance is not a problem. You can do it. It's work, but you can still do it. But if you're not adept at all, if you refuse to, you know, use those tools, then you're not going to be adept at it. And you'll feel it's impossible. You think this demand's crazy. How can I build a house like that? No way. So this is why a culture of repentance is so important, because you need to be raised from childhood to practice these, get used to these tools of repentance so that you become adept at them, so you can then use them and free yourself from this hideous closed loop of dualistic arrogance, the logic of arrogance, that cannot get out of its own way, that cannot get out of its own way. The logic of arrogance can never get out of its own way. Therefore, we have to set it down at its root, which is our desire to be greater than God. It's our spiritual desire. We have to say, hey, okay, I've played with that idea long enough. I feel I want to play with some other ideas. This is enough. I've had enough. And in setting it down, meaning in setting it down, you experience bliss. You're no longer experiencing the dualistic win-lose dynamic of arrogance. You experience the natural condition of bliss. This bliss, the peace, absolute undisturbed peace and bliss. Ram Maharshi is an example of that. This is what you experience. This is your experience. This is the ground of being. And so, this is what we have to do. It has to be done in that way. There isn't any other way you can do it. So, you know, just the lack of interest in the idea of a spiritual refuge in this planet is so extraordinary that you start thinking that it must be just a myth. This is a trouble. Nobody seems to be interested in it. Almost no one. It's just seen as some preposterous, ridiculous, wishful thinking. Even though I've been taken there and seen it already, at least one such situation, yeah, maybe it's even better than that. But even that, I still think that maybe it's just not so. Nothing that Jesus has said in his recent discourses points that out at all. He's not pointed to that at all. Maybe he knew that if you don't first have an extremely strong foundation in repentance, that you're going to be swept away. And even if he did say there was such a place, you would end up thinking he's a liar and a deceiver. And he's trying to attack you and prevent you from salvation. This is the logic of arrogance. We'll inexorably draw that conclusion. So he said, look, first you have to be adept at the tools of repentance. And only then will he offer sanctuary, acceptable offer to you. So there's no point in me saying anything about it right off the bat. You have to first, you know, do the work and become adept, and then I will tell you about what's what. And at that point, you will say, "Oh, okay, I can accept that. I realize it's not a trick or a trap." So I see this is a possible scenario. The fact that Jesus hasn't mentioned this yet doesn't mean he won't mention it at some point here. In fact, I did have a meeting with what seemed to be Jesus, and he did invite me to his home. He said, would you like to come visit my home? And this was a place that was nearby, was easy to get to, and it was an opportunity to leave a place which was very seedy, very sleazy, very lousy, very terrible, which is this world. So I did get the invitation. And I said, sure, yeah, I'll go, absolutely. Now, Jesus is not going to make this invitation to those who feel that it's a trick and a trap and trying to prevent them from working off their sin and guilt. You know, he's not going to offer it to them because they would feel very much opposed to it. They might initially say, yeah, and then start thinking about it and say, no, that's terrible. This is the sower of the seeds parable. Speaking of parables, let's go back to that. If we can, I don't know if this is going to work or not, because as this goes along, it gets a little buggy, which it seems to be now. It's, oh, okay, let me see. Parable of the sower. Let's go to that. Parable of the sower. Speaking in parables, he in the cove of parables, which is on the Sea of Galilee, about a mile south along the coast from Capernaum. Jesus could easily walk there, get up in the morning and walk there. And he gave the parable of the sower, very important parable, likening his teachings to a sower sowing seeds in the world, on a field. His teachings are like sowing truth in this world. He says, look, some of the seeds are going to fall upon rock, bare rock, and the birds are going to eat them, and then the seeds have no chance. Some will fall upon shallow soil, which has rock right beneath them, and the roots will hit the rock, and they'll spring up, won't have any ability to pull water into their growth, and the sun will wither them, and they'll die. That'll die. Some will be cast among the brambles and thorns. They'll get choked out by the thorns, and some will fall upon fertile soil and grow and bear a tremendous amount of fruit. So he realizes that his teachings are not going to reach everybody in this world. He said right off the bat, he spoke in parables because he said it's best that some not understand, that not think that they can understand at all, and just to kind of just say, whatever. Because they would feel like they're being attacked if he speaks too directly. And so he says, let those who have ears hear what I'm saying. So why do you speak in parables? He says, so those who don't have ears to understand will not understand. See, this is necessary to teach in this world, because people will feel, those who are caught up in the logic of arrogance will feel that the truth is attacking them and trying to deprive them of the opportunity for winning, which they think is salvation. Arrogance thinks that's salvation. So Jesus spoke in parables and then to the multitudes, and then when he was with the apostles, he actually explained more clearly what he was really talking about. And it's similar now that Jesus gave out a course in miracles here, and giving out this teaching, which is more advanced, more direct, very much so. And yet still, he may be speaking with some of his, you know, those of his apostles, those who are close, who are far along the path of repentance. He may be speaking with them and saying, telling them, you know, a little bit more information, actually, of what's really going on. That's quite possible. Again, in nowhere in the Course in Miracles or Journey Beyond Words does Jesus talk about any sort of spiritual refuge that he is, or what he's been doing since he's been gone, or has he prepared a dwelling place for us? Nowhere does he say anything about that. But in my meetings with him in spirit, he has indicated that he has a dwelling place and has invited me there. And obviously there's some with A Course in Miracles or with Christian teaching or any teaching who are farther along than others. Absolutely. Some are just getting started, and it's obvious. You look at them and it's like starting to play piano. You say, I want to take lessons. Okay, well, someone's been taking lessons for 30 years and have been practicing, you know, 8 hours a day. You know, they might be pretty doggone good at playing the piano. And somebody who's starting out, you know, they've had like lessons for a couple weeks. You know, obviously the one who's very adept can look at the one who's starting out and say, well, you're a beginner, which is fine. Obviously. And you can say, well, you know, a while ago I was a beginner too. You got to start somewhere. So it's wonderful, but don't make the mistake of thinking that beginners are the same as those who are very adept. As Jesus said, those who, you know, come to me as apostles, devotees, you're not the same as the teacher. But once you've perfected your understanding, you will be like the teacher, absolutely. There's someone coming here. Well, we'll see. Okay, so this is all very interesting. But it's quite difficult at this point to believe that there is a dwelling place. To believe that there is a dwelling place that Jesus has made, because there's nobody talking about it. There's nobody in A Course in Miracles community which is talking about this at all. No focus on it whatsoever. But as I have said, that this, an offer such as this, you could not accept it unless you were already very adept with the tools of repentance. You absolutely could not accept it. No way. So the first step is to become very adept at the tools of repentance. So that's what A Course in Miracles and the community and whatever it is that's helping, you know, encouraging and assisting, that's what they're focused on, which is right focus for them. But what if you've already done this? What if you've already become adept at these tools? Then perhaps the offer is made to you and you're clued into this, that there is such an opportunity. And Jesus always told me, don't get involved in the Course in Miracles community and groups and stuff. Don't get involved. That's not your thing. That's not what you're here for. You got to go faster. You got to go fast. You have your mission is to go really fast as you can, and don't stop for any of that stuff. Don't slow down. He says that if you get involved, that'll slow you down, because basically, in a lot of groups, they go only as fast as the slowest member is going, because they don't want to leave anyone behind. And he says, if you get involved, that'll slow you down, and you'll fail at what you're here for. So don't get involved. Go as fast as possible. That's what I was told. That's what Jesus told me. He said, don't get involved with that. Don't even tell anybody you're doing the Course in Miracles. Don't even talk about it. Just go as fast as possible. So that's what I've been doing. Now, here and there, there may be people who are ready. Here and there, there may be. Occasionally, some come here and watch these videos that seem to indicate they do have some sort of capacity. But what I'm seeing is it's not easy. It's not easy, and there may need to be some sort of, you know, groundswell of reassurance for this, if indeed there is an opportunity like this. Because you, as Jesus said, he talked about the parable of the sower. Let's go back to the parable of the sower. And he likened, you know, the situation that there are those who initially have an enthusiasm for his teaching, but then later on, when the pressures of arrogance, the logic of arrogance says, hey, wait a minute, you know, what about, you know, this logic, you know, how are you going to succeed? They panic, and then they turn against him. This is what he's talking about. And then the ones in the brambles and bushes that get choked out is you want to go along with it, but you're trying to please both arrogance, logic of arrogance, and repentance. You're trying to please both, and the logic of arrogance will choke out your determination that way. You'll lose momentum. Okay, this is another type of problem that we have here. He's showing the different mindsets in this world. One, reject his teachings completely outright. Two, have initial enthusiasm, but then panic when they don't have the tools of repentance. They say, whoa, wait a minute. This sounds to me like a trap, trying to deceive me. I mean, Jesus was rejected in his Nazareth, his hometown. They said, hey, you're a deceiver. You're a liar. You know, they called him, he's the Antichrist. He's Satan. He's terrible. Who are you? You know. They reject him. He was rejected in various places, very strongly. And so this he's talking about, these are seeds that fall on very thin soil, that the roots don't go deep until they hit the rock, and then suddenly hit the rock of what? Arrogance. And arrogance says, hey, wait a minute. How can you get rid of your guilt if you go to a place that's perfect? That's crazy. You know, who is this teacher? He's a deceiver. So there's that type. The other type is they say, yeah, I hear you, Jesus, and I want to do this, and I'm going to try to do this. And yet at the same time, they're also trying to please arrogance. Say, yeah, but I also need to work off the guilt, too. I need to do both. And so the stress of trying to do both is like the seeds in the thorn thicket of thorns and weeds, where the stress just chokes you out, and you lose momentum, and you fail that way, and you don't bear fruit. Only the ones who put the deep soil, where the roots go as far as deep as possible, and still there's fertile soil, only those are fruitful. So only some are going to be fruitful and hear his teaching and bear fruit. And I've been fortunate enough to get this far. It's been a great struggle, for sure. I absolutely agree with Jesus and this parable of the sower, that this is the way that it is. Now, this cove, you see Jesus on a boat out here. What was said is he went to the cove of sowers and began teaching in parables, and the multitudes were so vast there, they're you know, filling the whole cove, that he said, okay, got in a boat and just sort of anchored the boat, or just rowed the boat out into the cove here, just a little bit from shore, and then spoke from there so the people could crowd all the way to the shore to hear what he had to say. And that area of the cove of the parable is actually a natural amphitheater with really great acoustics. So when you're speaking from the shore, like he's, or from the cove, the people have tested this out. When you speak from the cove, your voice is heard way up on the hill, actually. There's some amplification, some effect that this cove has, that your voice is heard at a great distance. So you can speak to a great many people here. There's natural acoustics there. So it is said that this is where Jesus actually spoke and gave the parables. This is in Luke, the parables, the cove of parables here. There you have it. Jesus is out in a boat, and the multitude is on the shore here listening to what he's saying. And he's basically saying, hey, look, some of you will reject me outright. Some will go initially have enthusiasm and then turn against me. Some of you will try to go along, but will struggle and ultimately quit. You won't condemn me, but you'll be unfruitful. You'll be pulled down by the concerns and cares of the world. Okay, all the concerns and cares of trying to please arrogance will pull you down, and you ultimately won't bear fruit. And some of you will find this deep fertile soil, and you will get it. You will get it, what I'm saying. So that this is what he started out. He started out telling the truth to people. Hey, look, this is the way it is. This is the way it is here. And certainly we've seen this in this world right now. There's some are rejecting the truth outright. And going all full in with the logic of arrogance. And they're the ones who are now claiming this infallibility and no consequence to their actions status. You know, basically divine status in the world. Everybody else has to, you know, will be their slaves, human slaves, lower than dogs. There are those who have turned against, who have previously had some enthusiasm, and now they're just, forget it, I'm not interested, and if, you know, I don't want to hear it, I just want, you know, bread and circuses, entertain me, and food, and whatever, just sort of apathetic about the whole thing now, you know. They don't want to hear it. They don't want to hear it. They were used to want to hear it. Now they don't. Okay, there's many like that. Many like that. There's some who are still trying, and yet they're losing momentum. They're being dragged down. And they realize, wow, I just don't have the momentum. I don't have the juice, you know, to do it. And then there's a few, some, who have the juice to do it. Say, yeah, no, I can do this. To get free of arrogance is not arrogant. To correct mistakes is not a mistake. So there's some. So we have the play of these four types taking place right now, right here, right now. You know, and there's some that say, yeah, if I only had the time, if I only had the health, if I only, you know, wasn't burdened out, then I would do it. Those are the types, the seeds and the thistles and the thorns and the thorns and the weeds, that they're being pulled down by not having enough time, you see. But you have to make the time is the key, which is what I have done. That put this first. For instance, I get up early Sunday morning. What do? I say, I'm going to tape right now. I'm not going to wait until later in the day when maybe some responsibilities might come up. And basically, I've had to pay the price of being people looking at me as lazy, black sheep, no ambition, not really a good person, because they don't see me desperately trying to, you know, serve the goddess and say, oh, yes, infallible goddess, you know, how can I make you happy? Oh, you don't like the leaves or the weeds over there or the weed. I don't do that stuff. I've stopped doing that stuff. I used to do that. I tried to keep everything immaculate so the goddess would be pleased with me. But now I've stopped doing that. So people look at me as like, what a bum. You know, what a good for nothing person you are. So you take a hit to your status within the idea of righteousness within arrogance. Arrogance looks at you as like, wow, what a loser. You're really going to have to be a slave for a long time. You're a born slave. You know, arrogance looks at you, wow, what a born slave you are. But also a lazy, worthless slave. Worst kind. Got to get rid of you. You know, that. So you do have that stigma that you have to shake off and not pay attention to, really. And I never allow myself to be pulled down. That people try, for sure. Why can't you do this? Why can't you do this? I found out that the do thises are endless. When I used to do nothing but try to do this, people say, oh, that's great, you're doing this. Well, you can do this for me, too. You know, the more that I helped the goddess, the more the goddess demanded of me. Oh, you've done all this and put everything and organized into this for them? Oh, well, I've got this huge mess here that you could take care of. You know, what a great opportunity for you to expiate your guilt. Look at this mess. This is exactly what happened. You'd serve one goddess situation and make that incredibly great, and then and someone said, someone would find out, oh, wow, look what you can do. What a good slave. Wow, wonderful. Well, guess what? Come here to my place and look at this situation. I'm like, God, what an unbelievable mess it is. And it was. I mean, you could be working there the rest of your life trying to organize and straighten out such a mess. And they say, here's a great opportunity for you to solve my problems. And by doing so, get rid of the guilt that you have through, you know, this historic, you know, inherent guilt, sin, inherent sin of slandering Eve, all these from the beginning. What a great, here you, I'm giving you a great opportunity, and what a good person I am for giving you this opportunity to be my slave and you know, clean all the dirt, all the dust off of everything, and plant everything, and turn my estate into a paradise for me. What a great opportunity I'm giving you. And if you did that, there'd be 10 more demanding. If there's 10 more, did it for 10 more, there'd be 1,000 more demanding it. Do it for 1,000, there'd be millions more demanding of it. Never ends. Never ends. So I had to finally realize that this isn't the way. It's very difficult because you think that you might be losing your opportunity. So instead of pulling weeds, I'm taping. What really happened was my physical health broke down. The strain of trying to please the goddess, that I can't do it, you know. I'm getting infirm. I just can't do it anymore. And that's a blessing in disguise, because now I say, hey, now I'm doing the time taping and working on the tools of repentance and realizing, ah, this is the trap. Now I see it. Now I see it. And I see there's weeds all over the place. There's leaves everywhere. I mean, there's disorder everywhere. You know, it's like, wow. I used to I'd say, oh my gosh, I've got to clean this up. I got to spend the whole day, all Sunday. I'd work all weekends, Saturday, Sunday, constantly trying to keep everything clean and looking great. But and be exhausted, you know. And now I say, ah, just let it be. Just let it be. Doesn't matter. I'll do a little bit if I have to, but bare minimum, you know, try to avoid anything at all. stop planting, you know. The drought's a blessing in disguise because I can let the plants die, you know, I can't water them. Simplified everything. So I have the time to do this. Now, fortunately, I have a wife who is helpful in that she says, you know, forget about TR. What are you doing? Stop planning. You're wasting your time, you know. It doesn't, you know, doesn't put all these demands upon me to take care of all this stuff. I said, just put concrete everywhere. Forget it. You know, this is a waste of your time. You're wearing yourself out. Can't do it all. So I don't have that guilt being piled upon me in some ways. In other ways, there's other people involved that do pressure me into all this. But I don't have everyone pressuring me into it, you see. So that's very helpful. So I say, I'm doing taping. I say, okay, great. No problem. Just, you know, be successful at it. The problem is the success is something that other people won't acknowledge. They think it's a trick. It's a trap. As an arrogance sees it as a trap. Arrogance sees perfection as a trap. Arrogance sees the state of mind of bliss as a trap. It doesn't provide the opportunity to win, to get rid of the guilt. See, so, you know, I'm already not winning, but I'm already being successful at this because I'm telling the truth here. But nobody's listening. Almost no one is listening. So they say, well, where's the payoff? Well, the payoff, from my perspective, is to go to take sanctuary. Yeah, ultimately. Or take sanctuary here in bliss. That certainly is sanctuary also. But it could also be sanctuary in another dwelling place too. But if you're not willing to go there, how's that help? How's that help those who say reject it? How's that help? So I don't know how it's all going to work out. So I've been put through the ringer here, absolutely put through the ringer. And I was saved from a very bad pathway of, saved from a very bad pathway. I'm going to go eat pretty soon here. We're almost done. Saved from a very bad pathway of serving the goddess. You know, I got, it's very difficult to escape that. The radical feminism has made it extraordinarily difficult to escape this because it's like an all-in sort of situation where they have taken the big lie and they decide to go all-in on the infallibility of women, and this leaves you no option as a man here in this world except to be a slave, actually. And so not having the tools, not being an adept with the tools of repentance, I felt like going to another place was too problematical. So I felt like I was trapped here. So I felt like the only route was to serve the goddess better than anyone else, and maybe I'd get some special treatment, you know, because of that. But I found out, no, you just become even more of a slave. The more you do stuff for free and a slave, the more they expect it for free. See, if you're willing to work for them for free, then the more they expect it of you. And that's the path that I was actually going down, where I was working for free. Being a slave, spending my money and gas and everything, insurance, car, whatever, and just working for free for women, cleaning up their estates, their mess, you know, the mess of their lives for free. No payment. And of course, they'd always promise me stuff, you know, promise me, but no, never. They already knew that they can easily change their mind. Women's prerogative, always change their mind. In other words, what they mean is make a promise and then later go back on the promise. Say, no, I'm not going to make good on that. Well, it's my prerogative to change my mind on that. Yeah, I offered you this, but no, I just changed my mind. After you've done all the work, that's when they change their mind. Well, maybe we'll pay you something for this. You do all the work. Say, nah, you know, you did say you can help me out. I think it's good for you to help me out. And I just don't have the money to pay, so whatever. Changed my mind on that one. So I was going down that road very badly of doing free work, free. Massive amount of responsibility and work, fixing all sorts of stuff, trying to glorify the goddess here in this world. And that's a bad, bad path to go down. But I saw it. I felt that that was the only route there was. Is how can I be happy in the future of this world unless I get some sort of special dispensation from the goddess? Because this world's gone all in on this now. The only other option I see is, well, enlightenment bliss, which seems very elusive, doesn't it? Or taking refuge in another dwelling place, actually. And that requires a tremendous amount of clarity to see through the charade of arrogance. Takes tremendous clarity, and I just didn't have it at that point. And I thought that I had done enough work with A Course in Miracles that I should have had it. So I kind of reached a point where I became vulnerable, because I just said, wow, the Course just isn't working for me. Or maybe this is what the Course wants for me, to serve women like this or something. And so I just didn't stick with it long enough, even though I thought I had. So unfortunately, I got back on track and have now been able to get to where I am now. But it's very difficult. Commitment is just extraordinary. That's necessary. Because arrogance is playing hardball with us, absolutely. It's pulling out all the stops right now. We're almost done with this video. Okay, it's pulling out all the stops on us to prevent us from bliss, from sanctuary, ultimately. Because then where is it?